come to this final session, I guess, we're at now of the IDEASpHERE. And this session's called Prisms and Poverty. And you'll be hearing from myself and Devah Pager, and we're from the Malcolm Winger Center for Social Policy and the Program in Criminal Justice. But I believe we begin with a video. Yes.
That's
it.
That's a big intro.
I was going to have some of my chicken. Wow. That was a little anticlimactic. Okay. Prisms and Poverty. That's our topic for today. So my name's Bruce Weston, and I'm chair of the program in Criminal Justice Policy and Management, and I direct the Malcolm Winger Center for Social Policy here at the Kennedy School. And our program's going to consist of two presentations. We're going to hear first from myself, and then we'll hear from my colleague Devah Pager, Professor of Public Policy here at the school. And the topic today is prisons, and we come to this topic really at a historic time, because over the last 40 years we've passed through a massive experiment in criminal justice policy. Long-standing principles of rehabilitation and proportionality in sentencing and individualized treatment were all substantially abandoned, and they were replaced by principles of retribution, deterrence, and incapacitation. So the main effect of this change in policy was a fivefold growth in the scales of prisons and jails in America. And sociologists called this system mass incarceration. And it represents a new chapter, not just in how we've responded to the problem of crime, but the institutional landscape of American poverty has also been transformed. Now, you might be thinking, how does an Australian sociologist come to be working on American poverty and incarceration? Well, Australia was a penal colony, and real Australian aristocrats can trace their ancestry back to convicts. So maybe that's the connection. Well, it's a good guess, but my family ties, some of them anyway, are a lot shallower than that. My mother came to Australia as a student from Thailand in the 1950s, and that was the time of the White Australia policy that prohibited everything but European immigration to Australia. And so when she arrived, she wasn't really the member of a minority group, because there wasn't any real group to speak of. There was just her and a few foreign students, all of whom were expected to return after they finished their studies. But my mum met my dad, and he wasn't going to Bangkok. And so they stayed. And Australia in the 1960s and the 1970s was not an easy place for a young Asian woman. And my mum encountered a lot of racism, and some of which we heard about, but most of which I tend to think not. And for much of her adult life, really, she was an outsider. Now, my mum's a law-abiding old Asian woman, so what does this have to do with mass incarceration? Well, incarceration is all about outsiders. If you weren't an outsider before you went to prison, you became one at the first moment of intake. And from my mum's perspective, a lot of life then becomes about struggling for agency and for dignity and a righteous place in the world. So first up, mass incarceration. I said we've passed through a massive experiment in criminal justice. What does this consist of? So this much is clear. The United States is the world record holder when it comes to imprisonment. And you measure the size of the penal system in a country with an incarceration rate, normally per 100,000 of the population, the fraction of the people on a given day who are behind bars. In Western Europe and other Western democracies, incarceration rates today, around about 100 per 100,000, one-tenth of 1% of the population are incarcerated. And it's been fairly stable for a long time. It's gone up in some countries and it's gone down in others, but 100 per 100,000 in the Western democracies. Now, in the United States, the rate of incarceration is nearly an order of magnitude larger, 700 per 100,000. 100 per 100,000in Europe, 700 per 100,000 in the US. Our closest competitors are Russia, Rwanda, Ukraine, and several other former Soviet republics. But our prison populations even exceed those countries on a per capita basis. The US accounts for 5% of the world's population and about a quarter of its prisoners. Now, we can also think about how unusual the United States is in historical perspective, and we've got good data on the scale of the American penal system that goes back to the 1920s. And for five decades, the American penal system was very stable, and its incarceration rate was about 100 per 100,000, just like in Western Europe today. But in the early 1970s, the system began to change, and it began to grow, and it grew every year for about 35 years. And so only in the last few decades we've seen this really extraordinary rate of incarceration in the United States. What does this mean in terms of numbers? Well, by 2012, we had about 1.5 million people in state or federal prison. There's people serving 28 months at the median of time served for a felony conviction. We also have another 750,000 people in local jails. So these are people who are awaiting trial or serving short sentences. Now this isn't the whole of the correctional population, because we have a number of people who are under the supervision of probation and parole authorities out in the community. We've got 850,000 people on parole in the United States, and another 4 million people who are on probation. You add all of this up, right? And we have about 7 million people now under correctional supervision. And this is historically new. This has only emerged really in the last decade or so. Now, for all of this incarceration, we might think that we have at least gained a lot in public safety. And a lot of research has studied the effects of incarceration on crime. And incarceration is thought to reduce crime by deterring people and by incapacitating them, by locking up people who might otherwise commit crime in free society. Most of the studies, though, find that the effects of incarceration are quite small. So a lot of studies show that for a 1 percentage point increase in incarceration, we see about 1/10 of a percentage point decline in the crime rate. We've had a massive decline in crime through the 1990s and through the 2000s. How much has the rise in incarceration contributed to the decline in violent crime? About this much, according to these estimates. So much of the decline in crime would have happened even without the doubling of the incarceration rate over the last 20 years. So while the rate of incarceration now is historically high, internationally unique, it's not the most important thing about incarceration in America. The most important thing about incarceration in America is its unequal distribution across the population. Men are about 10 times more likely to go to prison than women. African Americans are about 5 times more likely to go to prison than whites. High school dropouts are now 20 times more likely to go to prison than people who have been to college. Disparities of race and class and gender have produced really astonishing rates of incarceration, particularly among younger African-American men with low levels of schooling. So if we think about 2011, think about African-American men in their 20s and 30s. If they dropped out of high school, their incarceration rate now is about 35%. About 35% of all African American men in their 20s and 30s are now locked up either in state or federal prison or in local jails. Let's compare these men to a group of white men the same age who have been to college, what do we think their incarceration rate is?
First, just let me just be clear that that's not including those who are under supervision.
No, these are people behind bars.
Behind bars on any 30% of an entire population.
Absolutely correct. In jail or in state or federal prison. So what do we think is the might be the number for white men behind bars?
One box.
1%. It's less. It's about a third of a box.
Oh my
God.
It's
0.3 of 1%. So the risk of incarceration for black high school dropouts is more than 100 times higher than the risk of incarceration for white men who have been to college. Now, we can think about the statistics and the risk of incarceration in a slightly different way. Yeah.
Just you worded it was black male at age 20, 50, 20, 39 college.
It's about 4%. And nearly all of the growth in incarceration over the period of the prison boom since the 1970s has been concentrated in the non-college population. There's been very little increase in incarceration among people who have been to college. Now, another way to think about it is, well, what's the lifetime risk of incarceration? What's the chances that someone will ever go to prison at some point in their lives? And we might be interested in a statistic like this because we might think that incarceration confers a whole array of disadvantages that affect people well after they've left prison. What's the size of the pool that are at risk of these adverse life chances? So we compared two birth cohorts. One was born in the late 1940s. They're reaching midlife in the late 1970s, before the big run-up in the growth of prisons. And for that cohort, born in the late 1940s, for African-American men who dropped out of high school, the chances that they'll ever go to state or federal prison at some point in their lives was about 15%. Okay, now we're talking about the real deep end of the system, state or federal prison, 28 months of time served at the median for a felony conviction. We compared this group to another birth cohort born in the late 1970s. So they're reaching midlife now, and they've grown up through the prison boom. What are the chances that this group has gone to prison at some point in their lives? For these African American men who have dropped out of high school, the chances are about 70%. So for black men now, with very low levels of schooling, serving time in prison has become a normal life event. And it's new. This is new, right? We need only go back to a birth cohort that was born 30 years earlier to find a time when prison was not ubiquitous in the lives of these men. Now, the incarceration rate is so high today for one reason only, and it's because we as a society have chosen the prison as our way to mark the occasion of criminal offending. It's been a policy choice. Now, this is only part of the story of high incarceration rates in the United States. Incarceration has a range of negative economic and social effects. People who go to prison face a high mortality risk after they come out. They face a risk of poor health. The stigma of a criminal record damages economic opportunities, and Devah's going to talk a lot more about this next. But more than this, lots of people in prison means lots of kids with incarcerated parents. So there are now over 2 million kids with a parent in prison or jail. If we look again at the time series, there are now about 500,000 Hispanic kids that have a parent who's incarcerated. About 700,000 white children have a parent in prison or jail. And among African-American kids, about 1.2 million currently have a parent incarcerated. What does this mean in terms of proportions? About 1 in 9 African-American kids currently have a parent incarcerated. If we think about the cumulative risk of parental incarceration for the kids, for a kid born in 1990, an African-American child born in 1990, about a quarter would have experienced a father being imprisoned by their 14th birthday. Again, this is new, right? This has only happened in the last decade or so. The research shows that when kids go, when a parent goes to prison, kids do poorly. They do poorly financially. The kids present a range of problems, from depressive symptoms to aggressive behaviour to diminished school achievement. We're coming to learn that these problems are most serious with boys, with incarcerated fathers. And the risk, of course, is that incarceration becomes an inherited trait that gets passed along from one generation to the next. And this, of course, may set apart poor and largely African-American children from their counterparts in the mainstream of American society. So let's recap. The growth in incarceration rates was historically unprecedented and internationally unique. Increased incarceration was concentrated in our poorest communities. The improvement in public safety due to incarceration is usually found to be small. Beyond this, incarceration also adds to the disadvantage of the poor. Now, these are all elements of a vicious circle. Criminal justice system that's normalized arrest and incarceration in our poorest communities and weaken the opportunities of all of those in its orbit. The vicious circle of incarceration and poverty is really difficult to change. So how do we break out of it? How do we break out of this vicious circle? The exclusion through incarceration further impoverishes communities that under better circumstances might help themselves, but it also breeds cynicism about the civic institutions that might bring about reform. So the current era of mass incarceration, I've argued, it's created effectively an outcast group, a novel experience of poverty in America. We now have in our society a group of people who no longer share in the full citizenship and all of the opportunities that come routinely to the mainstream. There's been this enormous social distance created as citizenship has contracted. And so extending citizenship, reinflating citizenship, I think, fundamentally requires an act of imagination. The outsiders in our society have to be reconceived as insiders. That's fundamentally the political challenge, I think. From a policy point of view, we know exactly what a more rational and fairer criminal justice system looks like. The problem is political. How do we get there? Do we have the political imagination to reconceive outsiders as insiders? Now, for this to happen, I argue, the insiders of American society have to recognize something of themselves in the citizens to be. Okay? So, in April 2012, a research team at Harvard began a series of interviews with 135 men and women who were leaving prison, returning to neighborhoods in the Boston area. One of my first interviews was at a minimum security prison with a man called Peter, an African-American man who was in his late 40s and had spent most of the last 15 years in prison. Now, Peter had a long history of violence, and that was episodically associated with drinking and with drug use. And throughout his life, he'd dealt drugs and stolen cars and got in fights. In the following year after his release from that first interview, we saw in detail many of the challenges confronting those who leave prison. This is Mattapan, by the way, where we first met out in the community after prison. In the first week out, Peter applied to a community program, and he received work clothes and a mass transit card. And at first he divided his time between a friend's place and his sister's very crowded house that also housed her fiancé, her daughter, and her granddaughter. And over months, Peter began to develop a relationship with two of his three kids and their two mothers. He was closer to one mother and her child than another. He seemed to have focused most of his attention on his 10-year-old son, though he did what he could to buy both his children clothes and school supplies. Peter was enrolled in food stamps and MassHealth, which is the Massachusetts Medicaid program. Each month he gave his $200 in food stamps to his sister, though that's now expired and he's hoping to be reinstated. Through MassHealth, he's attended mental health and substance abuse treatment, and he's also had a physical and visited the dentist. Now, Peter couldn't find work initially, but he did enroll in employment programs, and he was doing maintenance and operating machines. The programs paid less than minimum wage, but he thought it was important to get into a daily routine. And so for 6 months in the work program, he'd get up at 5 a.m., I'd be ready to start at 6:30 and he'd work through to 3 p.m. Every 2 weeks, he'd report to his probation officer. Peter gets from place to place by mass transit or by walking. He's concerned that if he rides in the car, he might get arrested and be sent back to prison. So if he's arrested and drugs or other people with felony records are found in the car, that could be a violation. Peter's been in and out of employment. It's hard to find work with a criminal record. But he put in 6 months in a laundry, and at age 47, he worked for the minimum wage, which is $8.50 in Massachusetts. He's out of a job right now, but he's looking for work every day. Now, Peter grew up in the Lennox Street Projects. That's a public housing complex in Boston's South End. He was a runaway as a kid. And when he was young, he'd leave the house for weeks at a time. And he'd be living with friends, often drinking, using drugs, getting in trouble. One of his earliest memories of serious violence was at a brawl in midnight, a racial brawl between blacks and whites outside an Irish bar in Mattapan. He and his cousin were involved in the fight, and in that melee, Peter saw a white man stabbed to death. That was a midnight brawl in Mattapan. And that happened just outside the diner where we were talking 30 years later. And Peter was 12 at the time when he saw that. So mass incarceration looks a lot like this. It's not just a burgeoning prison population, but it's how American poverty has come to be lived. The poor don't just live below an income threshold. Low income accompanies the tightly correlated adversity of violence and addiction and mental illness and childhood trauma, school failure and labour market discrimination and housing instability and family complexity. These are the problems that are affecting our poorest communities. And on top of all of this, we overlay lengthy periods of penal confinement. So the reentry project, I think, helps us understand our political choices. Because of its intimate connection with American poverty, overcoming mass incarceration depends a lot on how much the insiders of American society can see of themselves in someone like Peter. Can we imagine a citizenry that includes Peter as much as it includes the rest of us? So he's sold drugs and he's been on both sides of serious violence. He's been locked up for most of his adult life. But for all that, he gets up at 5 a.m. and he looks for work now, or he goes to programs and he picks his son up after school. And he says that street life is well behind him, but the future is really hard to predict for poor men with long criminal histories. So, you know, could he once again wave a gun in someone's face, or abandon his kids, or relapse to addiction? Well, sure he could, absolutely. And a good part of Peter's humanity rests in that possibility as well. And so that's how big our compassion has to be if we're going to find a way out to retreat from mass incarceration. Just as we entertain the possibility and hope that people can change, we equally recognize that they can fail, and sometimes spectacularly. Humanity cuts both ways. So now I'd like to show a short video of Peter. He's telling a story. He's telling a story of driving from Boston to New York with his son to get him a suit for the funeral of his son's brother. a boy who was shot dead while waiting for a bus on his way home from school.
My youngest son to New York to get him a suit to go to his brother's funeral, and my mother called me because she had found out what happened. And I cried all the way to New York. My son was in the back seat asleep, but I could see that he was going through it mentally. And I cried. And I asked my mother, I told my mother, I said, Mom, if I change my life, will you take care of us? And she was like, who? And I was like, Papa, if I change my life, will you take care of us? And she was like, yeah. She said, yeah, just trust and believe and take care of me. So I made the decision to change my life. He's taking care of us.
Yeah.
He's taking care of us.
So the political question is, can we imagine a citizenry that includes Peter as much as it includes the rest of us? And we're asking of Peter at the age of 47, with all of the chaos and the violence that he's seen, that he make a change in his life. That's what the system is asking of him. I think we've come to a point where it's time for us to ask the same of ourselves. We need to make a change. We have to make a change and dissolve a little bit of that line that's created a second-class citizenship in our most disadvantaged communities. Okay, I'm going to finish by telling one last story. Ethiopia. And this is a story that's intended to suggest all of the possibility that can lie before us. So I was in Addis Ababa about a year ago for a research project we had studying justice institutions in Ethiopia. And I was at a dinner with two Ethiopian researchers. One of them, Mula Geta, told me about a colleague at his research institute, a German anthropologist. Well, one day the anthropologist was out in a remote area driving through a small village, and his car tragically struck a small child, killing her. The girl's parents ran outside to see what happened, and a crowd quickly formed around the anthropologist, and the parents tended to the child. The anthropologist asked that the police be called, but he was told that there weren't any police there. The village dealt with matters like this by itself. Then the anthropologist was told that he could go, but they'd send for him in a few days. So he returned to Addis, and later that week, a message came for him that he had to return to the village. And he was told that he had to return alone. So he went to my friend Mula Geta and he asked what he should do, and Mula Geta said, you have to go back to the village. So he went back to the village, and when he got there, he was escorted to a meeting with the elders of the village. And first he was told to pay 2,500 dirhams, which is about $125, to the family of the dead child. And next he was ordered by the meeting to buy a goat for the family, and he purchased the goat, which was then immediately slaughtered. The father of the dead child was then called to the front of the meeting. The anthropologist, already standing at the front of the room, was told to hold out his hand. And so he held out his hand, and his wrist was bound to the wrist of the child's father with the entrails of the goat. The village elder then announced that the anthropologist was now a member of the dead girl's family. And that was that. He was free to go. The anthropologist returned to Addis, and he was very upset. He felt he hadn't been properly punished, and he hadn't properly compensated the family. Mula Geta said to him, you've got to understand that for the rest of your life, you you are now a part of that man's family. You have all the obligations of a family member. You have to visit from time to time, and if they're going through problems that you you might help with, you should help them, just as a member of their own family would help. So sometimes our criminal justice system seems so large and so natural and so unchangeable, but it's only been with us in its current form for a few decades, and real alternatives are everywhere, like Ethiopia. So are we ready for change? Are we capable of this as a society? Can we dissolve at least a little the line that excludes the outsiders of American society from their status as full citizens? And maybe we're too fearful, or we're too angry, or we're too racist. I want to close by giving each of us a challenge. To embark on this project of change, we really have to know and understand the darkest corners of our society. To be good stewards of our community, we have to know and understand the most severe poverty in this country and abroad. And we should know and understand how crime can flourish, the costs of untreated addiction and mental illness and homelessness and food insecurity. And only then, when we understand how life is lived on the margins, I think, can we begin to see something of ourselves in others. And I hope, amidst all of the violence, that we can ultimately find peace and justice. So let me close there, and I'll turn it over to Devah. Thank you.
So we promise to leave lots of time for questions and discussions at the end. I think Bruce set the stage beautifully in presenting some of the broad dilemmas of criminal justice policy in this country. And I want to pick up on just one slice of this issue, which has to do with the problems of employment facing those coming out of prison. So why focus on employment? There are lots of issues, as Bruce pointed to, related to this population and this community. Well, for one thing, employment is such a central part of what it means to be an American, how it is that we view ourselves, and how it is that we form our identities. It's critical to achieving population is particularly powerful and relevant. Research suggests that for those coming out of prison, finding quality, steady employment is one of the strongest predictors in shaping whether or not an individual returns to a life of crime. And yet, even though work is such a critical part of the reentry process, we see incredibly troubled outcomes related to this domain outside. Roughly half to two-thirds of those coming out of prison remain jobless up to a year after release from prison. And so we see that this is something that there's not very successful traction. So I first got interested in this question about 15 years ago when I was volunteering at a housing authority agency in Madison, Wisconsin that provided services to jobless and homeless men. And I spent months there providing some basic services, but mostly listening to men describe their experiences in their search for work and their struggles in this area. And I remember one comrade, or one young man in particular that really stands out. This was a man named Greg, who was an African-American guy in his early 40s. He was energetic and talkative, really bright and charismatic, and yet he was out pounding the pavement looking for work and really struggled to find And over the weeks and months that I got to know Greg, he told me a little bit about what he saw as his main problem. So about 20 years earlier, he'd gotten mixed up with the wrong crowd. He was young, he made some bad decisions, and he wound up with a serious felony conviction on his record. And at least according to Greg, this was the reason that employers were not willing to take a chance on him. His record was showing up in background checks and was ruling him out of different possibilities. So I wondered, really, the single conviction so far back really be affecting his employment opportunities so substantially? Or was there something about Greg, about his level of effort, about his skill set, or about his personality that I wasn't this respect, it's not surprising that these guys are having trouble finding work, whether or not the justice system is affecting their outcomes. I mean, I think it's really important that we consider and investigate the extent to which a criminal record, in and of itself, is a barrier to finding work. So if people are being ruled out from consideration simply because of a prior conviction, then our crime policies may be playing this very counterproductive role, preventing opportunities for people to get themselves on a better path simply because of a prior conviction. So how do we figure out the extent to which criminal records hold people back from employment? Well, I really wanted to find an answer to this question, and so in my case, I designed an experiment. Specifically, I've used what's called an experimental audit methodology, which is a kind of field experiment. And the basic design of an employment audit involves sending matched pairs of individuals, or also called testers, out to apply for real job openings to see how employers respond to otherwise equally qualified applicants who differ only by some selective characteristics. So in this case, we hire groups of young men to pose as job applicants. So here are our, you can see, identically qualified applicants, some criminal records, some no record, whites and blacks serving as these applicants. These young men in the study were carefully selected to make sure that they had similar physical and interpersonal characteristics. We assigned them fictitious matched resumes that reflected identical levels of schooling and work experience. And then we put them through an intensive training program so that they would learn to present their work histories to employers in very similar ways. We then sent these guys out to apply for real jobs all over the city. Two applicants per job, and they applied for all kinds of low-wage entry-level jobs. These are jobs at restaurants, retail sales work, customer service, warehouse workers, laborers, couriers, drivers, etc. A big, wide range of entry-level positions. As I said, two applicants applied to each position, one presenting evidence to a criminal record, the other without. In this case, the criminal record consisted of a felony drug conviction, and the applicant reported having served 18 months of prison time and had just been released in the prior month. We had, as I mentioned, a black pair and a white pair so that we could look at the intersecting or joint effects of race and criminal background. We conducted these experiments in both Milwaukee and New York City so we could see how urban labor markets may differ or are similar in terms of these results. So what did we find? Here are the main results from the Milwaukee study. I present the percentage of applicants that received a callback or job offer by race and criminal background. Here are whites with no record, whites with criminal record, blacks with no record, blacks with criminal record. So what strikes you from these findings? What are the things that jump out?
That a white person with a criminal felony conviction had called back to his counterpart black without a criminal record.
Yeah, okay, all right. You're jumping right to one of the big findings. So we see that a white applicant here with a criminal record is doing just as well, if not better, than a black applicant with a clean record. So in that sense, these are really speaking to the results of race as much as anything in this story. Yeah.
Where is the Hispanic population?
Yeah, it's a good question. So we actually did not include Hispanics here. There's another piece of the study that does look at discrimination against Hispanics. In this presentation, I'm going to focus mostly on the black-white comparison because that's where the disparity is.
Well, if you go to Texas, you'll find...
that's a good point. Right. Yeah, no, fair
California,
point.
California, same thing.
Fair point. Any other big findings that strike you here?
The criminal record matters.
Yeah, criminal record matters a lot. So here, just among whites, we see that those with a criminal record are called back at about half the rate as an identically qualified applicant with no criminal record. For blacks, the record actually appears even larger. So this ratio is 2-1. For blacks, the ratio appears to be closer to 3-1. And so in addition to suffering the penalty of both race and criminal background, there seems to be an intensification here among African-American offenders. Okay, so those are the three main points that I wanted to callbacks at less than half the rate of equally qualified whites. And then, as the first gentleman mentioned, blacks with clean records are receiving outcomes that are roughly equivalent to whites just released from prison. And so I think this emphasizes the extent to which we need to think about the problems of reentry, not only generally, but also the specific dilemmas facing minority ex-offenders in this process. When we look at the results from New York City, we see some similarities, some differences. So the overall effect of the criminal record for whites was somewhat smaller, but here we see an even much larger drop for black applicants with criminal records relative to equally qualified whites. This comparison is a little bit different in the New York study, although we actually had another, these are groups applying to different sets of employers, so there's some noise in these estimates. We had another team in which we paired this applicant with this applicant, and we again repeat the Milwaukee results in which the black applicant with clean record did roughly had outcomes that were very similar to what happened with the patient. So these are the aggregate quantitative results. I also wanted to show you some of the experiences that these applicants had in their interactions with employers, just to sort of personalize and individualize the experiences a little bit more. So when our testers went to apply for these jobs, they always asked to speak to the person who was in charge of hiring. And often the conversations would start out well. These are appealing young men. They presented themselves very well. They were articulate. They dressed well. They were very well qualified for the kinds of positions that they were applying for. And so often the conversation started off really well, but there was a noticeable change in the rapport once the applicant's criminal record was revealed. So in this case, Kevin, one of our white testers, reports his experience applying for a job at a special food store. So he says, I noticed a sign on the door which read, help wanted, part-time, some experience. The employer told me he had great part-time positions. So the two talked for a while as the employer looked over Kevin's application. He then noticed Kevin was a parole officer listed with reference. Why did you write parole? I said I was currently on parole. The employer then looked me in the eye and said, did you commit a crime? I said, yes. He then looked down at the sheet and said, he really wasn't hiring right now. So here we see the criminal record seems to catch the employer by surprise, right? And all of a sudden, these many signs pointing to employment opportunities, the sign on the door saying help wanted, the employer emphasizing the great competition disappear as the employer decides he's not hiring right now or he's not hiring Kevin. Likewise, in this case, Anthony reports on his initial contact with an employer that seems to be moving along nicely at first. But then he mentions, the employer told me at the onset, well, she went to get someone to interview me. As she walked away, she looked over my resume. She must have walked no more than 20 feet before she stopped, turned around, and said, thank you, I'll pass this along. I can only assume that it was the result of my conviction. So again, we see how the issue of the criminal record really breaks the flow of incarceration here with the employer starkly affects the rapport that's being established. Now, despite these many unpleasant experiences, and you know, I think as the aggregate quantitative results suggest, in many cases, employers were extremely wary of these applicants, we did see at least some fraction of employers that expressed really sympathetic reactions to these testers upon noticing the criminal record. Actually, in about a third of the cases where the applicants were able to talk to the employers appeared quite sympathetic and understanding. So in one instance, for example, Kevin, again, one of our white testers reports his experience applying for a job at a car dealership. So here he says, the employer saw the correctional facility on my resume and said, we're not the people on the employer, we don't care about this. About 75% of the people in the business have a record anyway. So Kevin then describes the end of the interview. He says, the employer said he was going to call me. Then he said, I know what you're thinking, Cecil. He's never going to call me. He will call you, not because you have good sales experience, but just because you need a chance. And the employer did, in fact, call Kevin 2 days later. Mm-hmm. Black ex-offenders also received some sympathetic responses from employers, slightly less than a third of the cases in which they talked to employers. So in this case, Anthony reports the employer had a lengthy conversation about the specifics of his criminal background and kind of what he was doing to move beyond that experience. And at the end of the interview, the employer says, don't worry, I find it good. and this is especially true among applicants that had a chance to actually talk to employers to develop a rapport, to strength, to demonstrate positive qualities. These are places in which employers seem to be willing to look beyond the stigma of the record. So why is it that we're seeing this big race difference? Well, a couple of factors intensified the negative effects for Black job seekers. First, Blacks were significantly less likely to be offered the chance to interview or have a conversation with the employers in the first place. So this meant that they were less likely to be able to demonstrate these positive qualities that they were bringing to the table or to contextualize their conviction in ways that showed that they didn't meet the stereotype of the ex-con. So Blacks were about 30% less likely to be invited to have a conversation with the employer when they showed up to apply for the job. And second, when there was ambiguity about the criminal record, white testers were more likely to be given the benefit of the doubt. So while establishing contact with the employer was more difficult for Black applicants, the consequences of not doing so were much more harmful. And so these two factors really shape this differential effect for Blacks and magnify the impact of the criminal record for those job seekers. Now, just to drive this point home a little bit further, as I mentioned, we also formed teams in which Black and Latino applicants presented no criminal record, and they were paired with a white applicant who presented evidence of having a felony conviction. And so I'll just present one example from this team where the three testers applied to a car dealership. So first, Joe, one of our African-American testers, applied, and he was informed at the outset that the only available positions were for those with direct auto sales experience. So he was written off right in the beginning. Next, Josue, his Latino test partner, applied, and he was told something similar, but his lack of direct sales experience was actually less of an issue. So he says, the employer asked me if I had any customer service experience, and I said, not really. He then told me he wanted to get rid of a few bad apples who were not performing well. He asked me when I could start. Josue was told to wait for a callback on Monday. He actually did not receive a callback and didn't get the job, but he received somewhat more favorable treatment. Next, Keith, their white ex-felon test partner. So these guys didn't have any criminal record. Keith applies, showing his evidence of a felony conviction. And he receives a stern lecture from the employer, who says, I have no problem with your conviction. It doesn't bother me. But if I find out money is missing, or you're not clean, you're not showing up on time, I have no problem with any relationships. And yet, despite these evident concerns, Keith gets offered a job on the spot. And so we see in these cases how race trumps even known criminality. And this is, I think, a really important point to remember. So this incident recently surrounding Donald Sterling, I think, reminds us that there are racists out there. But I think in some ways it's distracting because it's tempting to think that there are just a few extreme bad apples out there, right? Mostly from the old bad apples who are not representative of this more post-racial community.
Yeah, Diva, are there any data on the race or ethnicity of
the employer?
I'm jumping ahead.
Yeah, I'll take questions. In general, there weren't enough African American employers in the sample to really look separately at the importance of the race. I think there is evidence from other studies that the race of the employer does make a difference, but the vast majority of hiring managers in the world have to be white. So we're tempted to think that the racists that are out there today are just these bad apples. But in this research that follows hundreds of employers across two cities, we find that Blacks are not given half the chance that they're equally qualified white counterparts, and in fact viewed as no more employable than white applicants who have just been released from prison. In some ways, these results actually point to the far-reaching effects of mass incarceration. The massive racial disproportionality that Bruce mentioned, with more than 1 in 3 young Black men winding up in prison over their lifetime, casts a shadow over all Black men. And perhaps in part as a result, we see these troubling results with Blacks being viewed with suspicion, even when they have no official record of conviction. And so thinking about these joint effects of incarceration and race is a really important piece of the story. So overall, just to conclude, the results show a strong reluctance these are all relevant issues that employers have every right to consider. But in this extremely heterogeneous population, it's really difficult to work out who are the guys that really are setting themselves on a better path. And as we pass this incredibly wide net, more and more people, nonviolent offenders, first-time offenders, people that have experienced a profound change in their life's direction, are in this pool and are being treated as this monolithic group of individuals considered non-hireable. Now, personal contact, of course, is especially important in this process in helping employers develop a rapport, getting a sense of the gut feeling for who to hire, and especially in these low-skilled jobs where there aren't official credentials or kinds of work experience that are necessarily important for these jobs. That kind of gut feeling is particularly important. But we see this criminal stigma represents a very difficult barrier to overcome, and particularly for blacks who are not given the chance to make that personal impression, that stigma is intensified. Now, this work, I think, points to a number of specific policy implications that I'll talk about, and then I'm hoping we can broaden the conversation to think about these issues of criminal justice policy generally. So the importance of rapport building, first of all, particularly for applicants with stigmatizing characteristics, I think itself points to some important policy implications. And there are initiatives that facilitate the matching of applicants with employers, particularly for the undocumented population. So the recent growth of intermediaries, I think, is one promising model. These are groups that develop relationships with employers and provide a role in screening and placing, and in some cases even training, ex-offenders who are ready to work with employers that are looking to hire them, and help to kind of broker this trust gap that exists within this population. And I think that's one promising direction for research. A second has to do with policies that think about regulating or restricting criminal records. And this is an approach that's actually been gaining traction around the country. Have any of you guys heard of ban the box policies? Yeah, okay. So this is a kind of ordinance that's been passed now in more than 50 cities and or states that essentially restrict employers from accessing the criminal record of applicants until the later stages of the hiring process. So once an employer has been through the screening and interviewing of applicants and have identified a potential hire, they then can go and do a background check. And in the context of that personalized, individualized review, can decide whether or not the criminal record represents something that is directly relevant to the job in that case-by-case basis. And so this allows applicants to go through the hiring process without the stigma of the criminal record hovering over them, and to present their more appealing qualities in the context of a more individualized review. Now, we don't yet have research on to what extent these policies are affecting hiring outcomes of the ex-offender population, but again, I think it's one problem to look to. Now, those are just two specific policy approaches that deal very specifically with the stigma of the criminal record. I'd like us in our discussion to, I mean, we're happy to entertain questions and comments about either of our presentations, but I'd also welcome the broader discussion. Thank you.
My name is Councilman Nick Rosey. I'm a councilman in Baltimore City, and I'm the lead sponsor of Ban the Box in Baltimore.
Yeah, great.
And it just actually recently passed about a month ago. It's the most progressive form of Ban the Box in a major city.
I think private and public employers.
Yes, it's private and public.
Can we do some research in your city?
That's what I was going to talk to you about that. But and I say that it's specific to the private sector. The bill, what I found in my research and talking to folks, and you know, just growing up in Baltimore City, being from Baltimore, having my family members affected, having friends affected, the implicit biasness of the hiring process, right? And a lot of employers were willing to understand what being in the box means on a very superficial level of taking the box off the application. Yet they want to have during the interview process, either right before or after the first interview, the ability to inquire, because they feel like it's a cost of, it's an expense that they have to put out if they get towards the end and find out that the person has, you know, a criminal record that they're unable to stomach. But my argument to them from an HR perspective, what policies and procedures could you put in place to ensure that your hiring managers do not invoke any implicit biases on individuals with criminal records? And it's really impossible to do that. So the only real way for our country to drive to fair hiring policies and practices, you must remove that out of the entire interview process altogether and push it at the conditional offer. And my argument always was, it's very consistent to the way we do drug testing. You know, we don't drug test, you know, every applicant or the vetted process or the pool that we're going to interview. We drug test after we know that this individual, based off of characteristics or schooling, past experiences, or their interpersonal skills in the job interview, we let them go through that, and then we provide them a conditional offer, and then they have to take a drug test. If they pass the drug test, then they kind of have a job. And that's how we should look at it from a criminal record perspective. Because if that has anything to do with the hiring process, and we're even able to see when you look at, you know, African-American males as it relates to their counterpart whites having the conviction, African-American males not having the conviction. Imagine, you know, the statistics on when you put the conviction on the African-American male. Just one last thing. When you look at a city like my city, you know, in a very rich state of Maryland, in a very poor city of Baltimore, 60% of all of our folks returning home from Maryland State prisons wind up in Baltimore. Right? Their addresses are shipped to Baltimore. And we know that 41% of those in the first 36 months will wind back up in the criminal justice system, recidivism, right? ACLU came out with a report that basically said that Maryland was fourth in the country of marijuana possession convictions. And Baltimore City had a high disproportionate amount. Young African Americans were in those high disproportionate amounts. A lot of times we talk about that being the gateway to drug use, but really it's the gateway to the criminal justice system. And one thing that you kind of said earlier that I thought was interesting is when you talked about violent crimes or felonies. But I think the issue, when you look at the empirical data based off race, it's really exacerbated just off of any image. And we were also able to find that through some of the applications, the question was so ambiguous. Some questions said, have you ever been arrested before, period, right? So, I mean, I think that there's so much roadmap in front of us to push this ball forward as it relates to try to drive into fair hiring practices. Because this is not just that individual or their family or their community impact, it's societal impact as it relates to trying to stem poverty and as it relates to providing meaningful opportunity for folks who really want it. I ran into one guy, I know I'm talking too long, but this has been something I've been working on for probably the past 6 months, so I'm glad it's over. But I ran into one guy, he's 47 years old. When he was 17, he was with a group of four other guys. One of the guys had a gun. They robbed somebody. He didn't have the gun, he didn't hold the gun. Anyway, he spent 10, 12 years in prison. Came out, he's been from job to job to job to job. Never gotten conviction, never gotten any trouble, never been arrested since. And he said, the mistake of me being with that group of guys when I was 17 has followed me all the way to age of 47.
Yeah, which is large. Thanks for sharing. You know, I just want to point out, though, that, you know, one of the reasons that it's so important for us to have some research on the effect of policies like Ban the Box is that the implicit biases that you talk about affect not only employers' views about offenders, but also employers' views about black men generally. And so there is some concern that if you remove information about criminal records, that will intensify this effect of employers treating all black men as potentially being criminals and dismiss, you know, and intensifying the racial discrimination that we see. And so I think we want to be clear about the impact of these policies and how employers are responding. Yeah.
A couple of comments on my question. I'm Jack Mills. We run something called National Network of Sector Partners. Our network is the intermediaries that you're talking about, not particularly designed to address the needs of ex-offenders, but lots of them do. And we are working with the Lawyers Committee on Civil Rights. And I want to say there's resources if folks are interested. EOC has recently promulgated new rules on use of criminal records and hiring, and the Lawyers Committee on Civil Rights has a guide. So those are two resources. Here's my question. I was interested, I think, my notes said the key to reducing likelihood of a person returning to a life of crime is employment. So making the case for changing these rules, for changing the culture and employers' behavior on hiring, changing public policy, can be helped by that kind of evidence. Where is it available? Can you go into it a little more right now?
Sure. So one study is a really well-evaluated study of the Center for Employment Opportunities in New York that is an intermediary service that provides sex offenders So just for those of you that aren't familiar with their services, they provide individuals with day labor immediately upon release, and NVRC, the random assignment or RCT evaluation of that intervention, and found that for those that enrolled within 3 months of release from prison, and participated in this work release, and CEO also helps to then place these guys in longer term employment, their recidivism rates were significantly lower at the end of the year. So it suggests that this early employment following release has a substantial impact on longer term. Actually, a year from release and then a 3 year follow up, they also show large reductions. So it suggests that employment really is an important
just in your study, were there any disparities that you noticed in the results with respect to how the criminal record was made part of the interview process? So between someone who listed a parole person as a reference versus someone who just put like a prison sentence or someone who put working in prison as a, did that change how?
Yeah, so we standardized that so everyone presented the same kinds of information. So it's hard for us to. Maybe ways of presenting the information that is, you know, less threatening than others, but we weren't able to either control for how employers, in what order employers were looking at the information, or how they, you know, how they talked about the information with applicants. So we just made that standard.
I was in a session yesterday on inequality and growing inequality in the country, and it was focused mostly on class inequality. And I asked a question about the racial differences and what the policy implications may be, and the response I received was, this really is about class, and race is more overlapping, but it's not really about racial differences, it's about class. And furthermore, the implication of the answer was that if we talk about, if poverty is always associated with black people of color, that people don't care as much about poverty, and therefore we shouldn't talk about it in that way. Which to me was a very concerning answer because A, I think the answer in itself says there's a question of race. And B, you know, the research is pretty darn clear in our history in this country of racial differences. Legally sanctioning discrimination is also very clear. That I guess I'm concerns me that there's, you know, some of the foremost researchers coming out of Harvard are dismissing that as an important piece of this equation, and it seems to me that if we gloss over the differences in race, the policy difference, there are policy reasons why there are differences in race, and if we don't address policy also through race, it doesn't seem like these sorts of gaps will ever close. So I guess
I think that's a useful comment, and you know, to some extent, that's a question of politics as much as policy, right? If we think that universal policies are more likely to gain traction, they're not going to target the source of the problem as directly, but are they better than nothing? You know, I think that's a different question from whether race and direct racial discrimination, racial inequality remains a really important feature of American society. I think they're the question.
I guess my question really piggybacks on that. I want to dial back a little bit to what Bruce started with. To me, there's still a lot of time on sort of who's getting screwed worse and sort of dividing up, you know, how bad and how policy is within the justice system. But the first shot, really my mind-blowing slide for me was when you get back into how much we accelerate for 100,000 people in the U.S. and then how it compares globally. So either we're terrible people or we have different broad policies. So if we could think about what's driven the broad policy to have so many people wind up in jail, period, and then what would be the points that would more rapidly reduce the absolute number, whoever, indifferent to who's getting hurt, but there are too many people getting caught up in it. What's driven? Is it all drug policy, or what's the link?
That's been a big piece of it. The origins of this really go back to the politics and social change in America in the 1960s, before the growth in prison populations really took off. And so that was a period of rapidly rising crime, and crime increased a lot in the 60s and the 70s. And so murder rates by like 1981 were double what they were 20 years earlier. But at that same time, of course, there's a ton of civil rights activism and anti-war protests, and there's a lot of urban disorder as well. And it was in that context, in that really volatile social and political context, that policymakers, politicians, began to craft a tough-on-crime language. Really at a national level, it was very different from what we've seen historically. And it was that kind of language that became the origins of tough drug policy and the war on drugs. And a sort of second war on crime that consisted of things like truth in sentencing and three strikes and so on, that added very long enhancements for violent offences. And so it was those three kinds of policy changes: war on drugs, long enhancements, particularly for violence like three strikes, and mandatory minimums for other kinds of offences. And so how do we roll this system back? From a policy point of view, we have to review drug policy. I think there's a very live debate in the country now about drug policy and decriminalization and legalization, which has gathered momentum incredibly quickly. There's beginning to be a discussion about mandatory minimums. At the federal level, the Attorney General is already instructing his US attorneys on curtailing their use of mandatory minimums. And that's a really big development. The toughest thing of all, I think, is long sentences. And this sets the US apart from other countries like nothing else. And so there are 150,000 people in the United States right now who are serving life without parole sentences. And in Europe, the number of people serving life without parole sentences is 14. And we impose very lengthy sentences that are just way out of whack with international standards. And that strikes me actually as a pretty hard political conversation. And that is
what
not
What does it cost to keep somebody in prison for?
So it's about $50,000.
If you paid them $25,000, you have less cost.
And the evidence is actually the strongest on the impact of long sentences in terms of reducing crime. There's just very, very, the evidence non-existent that keeping someone in prison for 5 years as opposed to 2 years has a demonstrable effect on crime rates. And so we're spending all of this money with very little.
Just a couple of things. Okay, and I'll be real short, but I think there's definitely two things I want to say. One is that race is most definitely a factor in who goes to prison. Okay, it's not just about poverty. Okay, I have worked in the children's justice system and criminology and corrections major, so I'm very familiar with this matter, and I know that without question, race is a tremendous factor. You know, poverty is too, but poverty is more about family and everything else, and not just for criminals or for people that are going that's a, such an important thing. And I'm a little concerned, I'm a little disappointed today because I think that as diverse as this group is, that and not including the Hispanic population in this presentation is short of my expectations for certain, because I'm fully aware of how serious the situation is with the Latino population in this country and how much worse it's going to get as the Latino population continues to grow. Mm-hmm. Should I say that?
Point well taken.
One more follow-up. One thing that was interesting, you sort of talked about if you're coming out with a black mark against them in terms of in terms of having a criminal history that hurts your chances.
Yeah.
Is there any movement or ability to work for expungement? Like you, beyond, used to be like you served your time, you went to jail, you did your thing, you paid your crime, and then you go back into the community. But clearly that's not good enough, because people look at your resume and say, well, you served your time, but I still hold it. Is there any kind of...
Yeah, so this is, you know, this is something that's decided on a state, on a state by state, case by case basis. The issue of sealing records and expunging records, and some states are more generous in their policies than others. But one real problem that hasn't been systematically addressed is the fact that even if your record is expunged, the private services that are compiling and distributing criminal record information aren't well regulated, and so they often have information that may not be information that's supposed to be public, and yet it continues to show up on criminal background checks. So there's a lot of there's precedent in terms of the Fair Credit Reporting Act that those that are distributing credit information on people are regulated very carefully, that you're not allowed to provide information that dates back more than 7 years in order to give people a second chance and moving beyond these financial crises or issues. In terms of criminal record information, it's kind of the Wild West in terms of reporting and dissemination, and so there needs to be much better management of those private and public services.
One thing I'd say on this too is, I mean, this is something we hear, we heard it in the audit study in New York, and we hear it in Boston as well, and it's a big challenge for policy, is that there's just a lot of information out on the internet, right? And so if someone walks into your office to apply for a job, forget about a criminal background check, I mean, they'll Google you. And if you show up on a police blotter or something like that, they don't need to do a criminal background check. And I mean, it makes me think that an even more proactive approach, instead of limiting access to records, is to create this as a more robust basis for employment discrimination, hiring discrimination. And it's really hard for me to see how to limit the effects of that kind of thing, the use of Google in a job application without any discrimination law with real enforcement behind it.
I was just going to say, in the age of technology too, where a lot of times, a lot of applications, you have to create a profile and go online, fill out the application, check the box in the application, and they automatically have the algorithm set up to vet out the pool of folks who check the box. So, you know, and then that's known in, you know, certain industries. So you're right, but you know, in Maryland, where I have my main point of reference, we have a Maryland judiciary case search, where anybody at any time can just log into Maryland Judiciary Case Search, type in your name, and boom, they have every time that you've ever had it, from a traffic ticket to, you know, a criminal conviction. Well, not even a conviction, actually, then, of course.
I'm going to go back to the mandatory minimum thing for a minute. Do you know if there's any research about whether there are certain types of crimes for which having a mandatory minimum actually could produce a positive effect? I feel like I recently heard about around gun laws having mandatory minimum, where if you're caught, if you're committed of a crime, no matter what the crime is, but you have a gun on you, you get another 2 years on your sentence, that will, you know, at least encourage people not to carry guns. Have you come across anything like that?
Yeah,
There is work on gun offences like this. I'm thinking it's Jens Ludwig and Steve Raphael, and it's we've just spent the last 2 years working on the National Research Council report on the causes and consequences of the growth in incarceration. And we were reviewing a ton of that research on mandatory minimums, and that's one of the stronger findings. And the view we came to in the committee was that the way deterrence works is it really depends a lot on the certainty of apprehension rather than the severity of the sentence. And so there are a lot of experiments now that are focused on giving people penalties with a very high degree of certainty and very, very quickly. And so there are drink driving experiments out in the western states, and there's an important probation experiment out in Hawaii where people are immediately under supervision or in the drink driving case, the certainty of apprehension is high because there's a device fixed in the car and they're drinking. So, and we were impressed by that research, which showed really strong effects. And so it appears that people are not responding. If we really want to use punishment to improve public safety, which I think is very difficult to do, actually, but if we want to do that, the way to do that is with certainty rather than with severity. Now there is this finding on the gun study, but then there's a bunch of there are other papers that are also looking at mandatories in which the effects are right. Large effects are hard to find.
Yeah.
Well,
if I know the policy implications that I was just thinking about this, the stigma and in the society, so how are you going to address this? Well, I thought the employees might have a concern that they customers might have this kind of like a stigma associated with the ace accounts. So what is the kind of recommendation for that kind of like awareness raising among the civil society, the whole community?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I think it's less an issue of stigma facing customers, because this is an invisible stigma, the criminal record. More dealing with employers' perceptions and preconceptions about the population. The EEOC guidelines, these revised guidelines, offer some help to employers about how to evaluate this information so that they're not just making blanket policies facing all ex-offenders, but are instead offering more individualized reviews that take into account the time since the conviction, evidence of rehabilitation, the specific relationship between the conviction being considered, and so I think all of that points to really looking at the applicant holistically rather than having this blanket policy that's eliminating very large swaths.
She may be referring to when the employer anticipates that his or her customer may not like what.
For racial stigma specifically.
I know like this kind of like a rule with the issue of conviction as well. I think not only the racial.
See, that's something that I think is invisible too. I think racial discrimination on behalf of customers, I think, is something that's very real. And I think there needs to be kind of more awareness about the potential and possibilities for this group. I think we have a very dark stereotype in our head, a very well-developed stereotype in our head about what this group is like, and I think that is kind of what employers are basing their decisions on. They're using this as an easy way to screen out applicants, particularly in periods where there are hundreds of applicants for given jobs. This is an easy way to weed out applicants in the initial point of application. So I think the more evidence and awareness there is that this is a population that's ready to work, that's able to work, I think the better. Do you want to talk more about sort of reducing that stigma?
Maybe we should take one last question, but
yeah, right.
uh, I,
I want to say something about race and race and ethnicity as well. So, which should we take?
Yeah. So this may be outside of the scope of your research, but I'd like to hear your thoughts on it anyway. It occurs to me, both geographically and in terms of the sort of striation that appears to exist within the workforce, that being a criminal, especially being an African-American criminal with a record, you become sort of almost a part of an unseen class. It reminds me a lot of the way in India they used to have, you know, the untouchable class that was not spoken about. You know, you did not associate with them. They were almost invisible to the rest of society. And with that in mind, it seems to me pragmatically very hard to develop among the general population a sense of urgency or even a sense of awareness, period, about this issue, because ultimately, you know, state, local, and federal officials are the ones who have the last say and the power to start implementing things such as in Baltimore that might work to rectify this issue. But those officials are, you know, largely, we are the people responsible for putting them in power. So how do you empower the masses to you know, be more aware, to expect more of their elected officials, and I guess to have the desire to learn more about the situation and see it rectified and actually, you know, vote accordingly.
No, it's a great point, and you know, I would maybe just like to end on a possible note of optimism here, that since 2009 we've seen the first reductions in the state level of incarceration since 1972. We've just seen a steady increase, but in the last few years we've seen a small decrease in the rate of incarceration. It's fairly trivial overall, but in some states like New York, they've reduced the incarceration rate by more than 20%. New Jersey, similarly, Texas has achieved more than 13% reduction in its incarceration rate over the past decade, even though it's this known as being this tough on crime state. And so we are seeing some evidence that maybe if there is a window of opportunity, we're seeing the lowest crime rates since 1960. The public is less concerned about these problems of crime and more open to the possibility of experimenting with different policies for dealing with criminal offending. Not to mention the fact that this has been a massively expensive experiment, and this is not a time when states are looking for ways to spend money. And so I think this is really an opportunity now to have this conversation to start rethinking the ways that we're approaching criminal justice policy and to think seriously about meaningful.
One last quick question. I'm sorry. This can be real quick. With everything that we've talked about today, when we looked at the chart and we saw the huge trajectory, you know, in the late 80s and the early 90s, when we're talking about drug policy, and even when you're talking about as it relates to, you know, the reduction in crime, there's always one common theme that jumps out at me, being from an inner city, is that the introductory of crack cocaine. And the lack of popularity of crack cocaine now. And when we talk about the increase of crime, when we talk about the increase of murders in cities where, you know, all across this country that had crack cocaine, when we talk about the reduction around crime now and the lack of popularity around crack cocaine, but then we also talk about the sentencing differences between like powder crack and crack cocaine, the 20% multiplier that relates to minimum sentencing disparity. Through all of this, I found it strange that neither one of you interjected the part of crack cocaine. Is that something that you guys don't really think is a huge variable in this, or we just didn't get a chance to talk about it?
Yeah, I think you know, drug markets and drug control policy has been enormously important in this story, and the war on drugs has been a policy development that's enormously important. I think, and the crack market, particularly through the 80s and the early 90s, was a very violent drug market. And if we look at like homicide rates in 90 and 91 and 92, I mean they just went through the roof. And all of those all of those homicides, offenders and victims, was concentrated among young African American men, 16 to 24, and that was crack. For 3 or 4 years, there was this incredible rate of really serious violence all around the crack market. But I think there, so after that episode, though, crack markets and drug markets more generally were pacified, and partly the markets sort of shook themselves out, and so there was less conflict between the people who were dealing. Marijuana became increasingly important in these drug markets, and that didn't have the same violence associated with it. So I would say crack is a really important story and has been enormously important for inner city murder rates in particular. And for me, it's reflected in a really dramatic episode in the late 80s and early 90s when murder rates just went through the roof. But it's one piece of this larger story in which there are a whole variety of social problems going on in poor inner city communities. Untreated addiction is one of them. Untreated mental illness is another. And you know, the only policy instrument really that we had for these social problems was the criminal justice system. Yeah. I did want to say one thing quickly about race, because I thought this was a brilliant question. I absolutely appreciate your comments also on the Latino population. And I think in this area of public policy, in criminal justice policy, it's often driven by it's a politics that runs very hot, and it can be very emotionally charged, and it tends to fall very hard on our most dishonored and disadvantaged groups. And they're not defined only in terms of their economic status. African Americans and Latinos are demonized in political talk about crime and crime policy. And for me, that suggests, at least in this policy domain, this is about far more than poverty. Poverty is absolutely essential, I believe. But the political dynamic is not in any way reducible to poverty. And in immigration policy now, all of the punitive sorts of instruments that we've seen for a long time in criminal justice policy are now finding their way into immigration policy, expansion of detention, and all of this. And it seems to me nuts, frankly, to minimize the role of race and ethnicity in contemporary immigration.